But in reality, I don't know what I want to do when I retire, when I get old, and I need to try all these things out. So I've tried living in an RV in the wilderness, not owning land, bouncing every 14 days. I know how that feels. So if I decide to do that, I know what's going to happen when that happens. The next thing I've done is I've done the houseboat thing where I bounce from island to island and river to river and I bounce around on that. And I know how that feels. And eventually, I'm going to know how it feels to go island hopping with the sailboat. And then I will try living off-grid on that property. And there's probably two or three other lifestyles I want to try. A riverboat in Vietnam, something in Alaska, anything in Alaska. These are all things that I need to try. And then once I'm all done with trying them all, I'll figure out which one sets best with me. And then that'll be the life that I choose going forward. But I'm not going, I don't wanna choose something that I like to do and never have tried other things that I might like. That's not what I want to do. I want to try everything first. And by try everything, I mean put a year or so into that lifestyle and see how it feels once it's part of me. This next couple episodes will be me fixing the sailboat, setting up the houseboat to go onto that property on my trailer, and also setting up the property in order to store my truck, my RV, and my houseboat there. I don't think very many channels go into detail about that, and it's such the logistical nightmare of moving things and getting rid of things and becoming tiny, minimalist. I don't think people focus on it enough. So I'm going to show you just the effort that it takes just to find a place to park things. It's about $90 to put a trailer in storage on auto pay. And the truck, the trailer, and the RV, the truck, the houseboat trailer, and the RV would be $300 a month, which gets into $3,600 for a year. So I just bought land for $3,500 and I pay $7 taxes on it. Seems like the cheapest way to do it. Everything is insured, so if something happens to it, it's covered. Not that I want anything to happen to it, but yeah. This next couple of episodes, we're gonna be looking at how to basically sit in a position where you can get in a sailboat and go to the Bahamas for a couple of years and not worry about coming back, or if something happened to my sailboat where I could just take the pets and come back and have a plan B or safety net, something happened to me, where I couldn't sail anymore or not feel comfortable on the sailboat. So we'll figure that all out in the next couple of episodes and we'll kind of show you my plan on that. It's not for everybody, but at the same time, it is showing you that I'm not just throwing everything into the wind and assuming that assuming that I'm going to live on this boat forever. In reality, I think I'm going to live on this sailboat for about 5 years and kind of spend a few months here and there coming back to Tennessee. Like hurricane season, I'll put my boat in a marina and I'll leave it. If it's really cold or really hot in an area, I'll leave for a few months. Stuff like that. So there will be times where I need another place to go, and I'm being kind of realistic about that. I don't know that every channel is. So if you're just looking for me to go to the Bahamas and go sailing, it's gonna come. It's not realistic that it comes that quickly. This trip is not a very fast trip. There are steps to take, and I'm taking them and documenting it along the way. So I appreciate it. Otherwise, if you like off-grid homesteading, I'm gonna go cut some trees and I'm gonna go basically just play in the forest for a week or so. In the next two episodes of you.
So until up to this point, oh, yeah. Up to this point, you don't really need four-wheel drive to get to my house, but from here on after, if you're going up the mountain,
thank you. shotgun, whiskey's gonna ease my mind. Beach towel dress on the drying line. Do I remind you of your daddy in his 88 Ford? Labrador hanging out the passenger door. The sand from your hair is blowing in my eyes. Blame it on the beach, grown men don't cry. Do you remember that beat down basement couch? I'd sing you my love songs and you'd tell me about how your mama ran off and pawned her ring. I remember everything. A cold shoulder, a closing time. You were begging me to stay till the sun rose. Strange words come on out of a grown man's mouth when his mind's broke. Pictures and passing time, you only smile like that when you're drinking. I wish I didn't, but I do.
For all intent and purposes, where the trailers are right now is the roadway. And in order for me to have these parked here completely legal, let's say I'm, you know, in the Bahamas, I don't want anyone to call me and say, hey, they're widening the road, you got to move your trailers, right? I would have to bring them to about where a river is. And you see how that's a hill, which really means calling in dump trucks and dirt and gravel. And then, I mean, ideally I would make something a retaining wall too. Now, I have a lot of trees around here, a lot of fallen trees too. So if I go buy even an electric chainsaw, I could make a retaining wall pretty, wouldn't be fun, but cut up pieces of log that you could actually carry and move it here and line it up against these trees and drill a big hole through them and put a stake through it. Wouldn't be that hard. I mean, it would be hard, but it wouldn't be impossible. And then you call for a bunch of loads of dirt to be dumped. And then you either take forever with a shovel to spread out the dirt, or you rent a skid loader and just do it in an hour. What I'm feeling when I look at this, right where river is, all the way down to this tree right here, it's kind of a straight shot. So if I could build a retaining wall right here and then make a turn, have this tree be the last part, you know, have the wall be on the other side of that tree. Come to here, go up that way. This would be a good enough spot to throw an RV. And it would also put you at an angle where you could walk around the front of the RV and have a wooden deck right here or what have you. So that's my thought number one, right? My thought number two is if I'm gonna use this place for parking stuff, which in reality, I'd like to have the RV and the houseboat parked here. I should just take out all those little trees right there and maybe even... I mean, that's at a high enough ground level where if I filled around that tree, that could be part of the driveway and just keep the tree. And just do it all. Well, you could park the houseboat right there and the RV right here. And the RV, depending on what angle you put it, wouldn't have to look at the houseboat. Yeah. And then right off to the edge of the of where the wall would go. River, come here. Hey. Shh. Come here. I'm up.
I had to leash him.
I know 3 or 4 of the neighbors that way. I don't know. There's only one neighbor this way, and I don't know him yet. But I do know that the people on this mountain all carry guns and they shoot first and ask questions and answer questions later. And a mad, growly dog with a collar on running at you is pretty good grounds to just shoot first and ask, what was the answer yours later? So we'll keep him on a leash for now.
Okay, when that hit the ground, nothing reminds you you're small and better than a tree moving. So, I need three rake lengths, which the rake is about 5 feet, so it's about 15 feet gap right there between these two trees. This log will do that. So I'm gonna figure out how to move the log. And then I'll start cutting longer branches to build the wall up a little bit. Still gotta cut down this tree. Looks like it's gonna fall this way. So, don't know that I'm gonna be able to carry it back. Might have to do it in smaller sections, we'll see. Good stuff though.
You can say the sun is shining if you really want to. I can see the moon and I see myself there. You can take a road if it takes you to the stars. Now I can take a road that I've seen you through. I can take a road that I've seen you through.
Next tree, this dead tree right here, I had to take it down because it'll just fall on the RV in a bad storm. I'm hoping that it'll fall like this and I can pry it up against this tree and its own stump right here. And that'll start another wall going that way. I'm hoping. It might be just way too big, and if it falls somewhere I can't move it, I'm going to have to cut it into smaller pieces, but we'll see. I use the rest of the battery on the chainsaw just starting to cut into this tree. I end up having to charge the chainsaw two more times, and I only get a third of the way through on one side of the tree and a third of the way through on the other side of the tree. And then I just rely on the Tacoma. So it's charging up. So to tighten the chain, it's got a little hand knob. You don't have to use a tool. That's also kind of cool. So I'm going to do that real quick. My logic here is I'm not going to just drive unless it starts falling towards me. But my hope is that when I pull on it, it'll crack and fall that way. But it could just come right towards the truck, and in which case I'm going to floor it. I'm in four-wheel high. I'm going to lock the differential. And I'm going to take off traction control. So if I have to go, I can go. But I don't know that pulling away with the tree makes the tree not follow me. Like, the faster I go might make it come down even harder on me, you know? So, yeah, let's just put a little tension on it and see what happens. I love editing these videos and watching myself figure out you're about to do something stupid. Like, I am literally about to drive the tree isn't leaning directly towards the truck. It's probably leaning, you know, 45 degrees away from the truck. But if you pull on it, it's eventually going to fall towards the truck. So as soon as, I don't even tighten it up. I start to drive away, and in my head I'm thinking, this is just stupid. Don't do it. Don't do it. I don't even put tension enough on the rope. Watch, I'm going to sit here and think about it. Look and line it up like, man, if something was pulling this angle, there's no reason why that tree wouldn't fall 45 degrees this direction. And the branch is on this side, aiming towards the truck. So I'm like, man, there's no way this is a smart thing to do. So as you can see, I had no tension on the rope once I pulled it off the hitch. In my mind now, I'm thinking I'm going to wrap it around the tree and have the truck at least go a different direction from the falling tree. So if I floor it, the falling tree will go towards the tree I'm wrapping around, and my truck will go a different direction, 90 degrees the other direction. But I didn't realize how stupid this was until I was lining it up.
Pull the truck this way, so it's at least pulling away from the direction that the tree is going to go. I don't, this isn't lining up the way I like it, so we're going to not do this. We're going to do it a different way.
So it is definitely cracking. You can see it's cracking right where I cut it, right there. It's not leading on anything, but there's no doubt that it's going that way. So I'm gonna yank on it this way a little bit, just to get that crack to go all the way through. And then, should come down, we'll see. Hopefully it won't hit anything. It should just crash into these trees, and then I'll be able to cut it up.
Well, that couldn't have fallen any better. Look at this.
This is so cool. So, I want a chainsaw. I'm going to use the pry bar to get the tree right there up above the stump. And resting against the stump right here, that won't be, I mean, that'll be a bitch, but it's not impossible. And then I'll cut this right here. And then this log will be between stump to stump. Right here. And that'll be the base of the retaining wall on this side. That's perfect. And then this part right here is for sure more than 15 feet, so I'll trim everything and get it, use that as part of the wall. This right here is just a heavy chunk. It might not be 15 feet, but it'll be great right in front of it to hold more dirt. So this is a wall, this is a win-win. And you can see where this would have came down right on my RV. So let me try to wrap this up. Well, to summarize, it's 3:30 right now and I'm gonna go back and have an early dinner and a couple of drinks, take the dog to an island, maybe even jump in the water. We cut down 5 pretty good sized trees, 4 good sized trees and 1 that's way too big to be messing with. We got a pretty good start on the wall. I gotta move this a little bit, but basically everything's kind of jumping from that tree to this stump to that tree, and it's all being held up by those 3 trees, and then we're gonna fill it in with some gravel and dirt. It's only gonna be about 2.5 feet tall, so it's not gotta be too crazy. My plan is to take stones and place stones along the wood so the wood doesn't get touched by dirt, and then fill it in with dirt, and then the wood will last a lot longer because it won't get wet when it rains, because the stones will just let the water through. Yeah. All right. River's ready to go. I set up the slide out. The RV is ready for us to come stay here if we want. Don't know, we'll see. This is actually cool to see. You see the size of the back of my boat and the size of the back of that Hunter, okay? My boat's a longer boat. The Hunter's like a 27 or a 28. My boat's a 30, okay? My boat's technically wider. It's almost 11 feet. This boat's just shy of, just over 9 feet. But you see how the back of it is huge? That makes for like a living area in the back that's a lot more comfortable, and it actually makes it where when you're in the 80s people started to sleep in the back of their boat, not in the front, because the beds back there were bigger. That's because of that. Now if you look how narrow the other boats were from the 70s, early 80s. Yeah, that's all Hunter right there. Hunter started that, and then now you'll get boats that are so wide in the back that they have 2 steering wheels. And it's like a sugar scoop back there and open deck, and yeah. That all started in the early to mid 80s. Before that, it was like this, where you want to not disrupt the water flow, so the back was narrow, the front was narrow, and the middle was huge. Get her to go on this dinghy.
Not like for a ride. Oh, don't tip over my coffee, you idiot. Oh, she's already feisty. Shit. She's mad. She's defending her ground. That's why she's in charge. Let's be honest. She's kind of the violent one out of the three of us. Whoa, calm down. Aggression gets you nowhere. She's me. She's me. Okay, we'll take a break with that. She sees something up in the roof that she's serious, wants to get at. Look at her. She won't take her eyes off of it. Oh, I don't see it. I think. I don't know.